It is a great pleasure to welcome to the bank Baroness Onora O'Neill, and I just want to say a few short words of introduction, if I may, to set the stage and then hand over to her first and then Andy to ask questions. It said science can give us knowledge, but only philosophy can give us wisdom. Onora embodies both. Student and scholar of philosophy, psychology, and physiology, her knowledge and wisdom have combined to bring to the fore a mind that a fellow panelist described as terrifying but brilliant. Hope we won't be terrified today, but certainly we will see some brilliance. Throughout her career, she has focused her brilliance on a wide range of topics, from genetics, as chair of the Human Genetics Advisory Committee, to human rights, as chair of the Equality and Human Rights Commission. Her seminal Reith lectures on a question of trust broke new ground about the relationship between accountability, communications, and trust, thinking that, of course, is highly relevant to our work, and, of course, highly relevant to today, which almost as by design, you would have thought it was by design that we launched our Vision 2020 strategy, which tries to tackle in a practical way some of these very issues, and tries to tackle in a practical part of the motivation for this is something that those lectures also anticipated, which was the elements of the advent of fake news and what can be done about it. I think we know as central banks that we are more effective if we're understood, if we're credible, and if we're trusted. But the question is, what is trust and how is that earned? Well, trust, she teaches us that trust is a matter of judgment. It's not a question of verification. And that placing trust requires judgment of available information, but it doesn't need complete evidence. It doesn't need proof. And for some time, around the time of those Reith lectures, 2002, but then beyond, a lot of the focus about building trust has been around accountability. And certainly, central banks, we started with perhaps an accountability deficit. Certainly, never. What was Montague's expression, Andy? Never explained. Never apologize, never explain. That's not quite where we want to be on the accountability spectrum these days. So we started with the deficit, but perhaps we have taken the question. One question would be, have we taken the transparency and accountability element as far as it can be taken, and how can we avoid being subject to what Baroness O'Neill has called managerial accountability, so a sort of box-ticking form of accountability, not true spirit of accountability. In terms of transparency, also, what's the right level of transparency, degree of transparency? We can't carpet bomb our way, if you will, to credibility by providing perfect information, and she's warned as well about the dangers of maybe excessive transparency, my term, in terms of our ability to develop policy and to make good judgments. And she has been very much at the forefront between drawing a distinction between greater transparency and improved communication. Now, this is very much on point and has been a motivator for our work in developing Vision 2020. I and Jenny Scott and others have benefited from meeting with Onora on a number of occasions. I think we all owe a service, particularly here in the PRA, for her service to the Banking Standards Board in building trust and accountability, responsibility and duty in the banking sector. But what I should do is get out of the way. I will remind you that it's better to trust a man who is frequently in error than one who's never in doubt. And I built that track record of error. That means that you can trust me when I say that this will be an enlightening, engaging, and highly relevant talk. So with that, I will pass it over to you. And I'm going to, if it doesn't bother you, I'm going to sit in the front row and take notes, if that's okay. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It is an unusual audience for one elderly philosopher, I have to say, but I've been some other places where people have discussed trust and trustworthiness quite a lot. And if there's anything I can bring, it is perhaps having looked at some of those other places. You are not alone in having had some issues in this domain. It is, of course, a cliche of today that trust has declined, and on the whole, people think that's a matter for regret and concern, and that we should then try to, the phrase is, the cliche is, restore trust. I think evidence typically given for all these claims is not compelling. Much of it is based on pretty unconvincing accounts of trust and mistrust, and much of it pays much too little attention to trustworthiness and lack of trustworthiness, or to the task of placing and refusing trust intelligently, which is the difficult thing. And then, of course, there are widely endorsed proposals for restoring trust, which are probably not going to work very well, and some of them may even fuel some mistrust. So I think there's quite a hole out of which to climb. Broadly, what I'm trying to focus on is the difference between the thought that we need to know more about trust and the thought that we need to do more about trust, to shift from the, if you like, the epistemic to the practical. So let me start with a very well-known body of literature on trust, which is, of course, produced by the opinion polls. And when people tell you trust has declined, they're usually pointing to opinion polls as though they provide the evidence. And what they do provide is evidence of what are known as trust levels, because pollsters ask respondents, you and me, anyone, about their level of trust in a certain type of institution, banks, companies, governments, or certain types of office holder, teachers, bankers, journalists, politicians. It's all very familiar. The evidence that one gets will, if the design of the poll has been adequate, provide a trust level. And this can then be compared with the trust levels accorded to other institutions or other office holders. And the comparisons can be tabulated, and then you've got trust rankings of different types of institutional office holder. And repeated polls might show, though they often don't, that there's evidence of changes in trust levels or trust rankings for specific types of institution or office holder across time. All of that's a journalistic staple, if you will. But where repeated and comparable polls have actually been conducted and reliable comparisons are possible, the polls don't always show that trust levels have declined. Good news in a way, but a bit disconcerting given how much is said about decline. For example, in the UK, journalists and politicians received very low trust rankings in the past, 20 years ago, and they still do. Judges and nurses received very high trust rankings, and they still do. So a story of general decline is not, in fact, borne out. Should we be surprised that the evidence of declining trust is less than is widely assumed? Of course, there are cases of declining trust, and as the years go on, we have more polls that permit comparison. I don't think so. I think that polls give us evidence only about informants' generic attitudes. That's what they're meant to do. They're generic attitudes to types of institution and types of office holder. And generic attitudes have one lovely feature, which is that they can float free of the evidence. It's also an unfortunate feature. They can even float free of the very best evidence that informants have about the trustworthiness or untrustworthiness of actual cases. So it's quite common for informants to say, oh, I mistrust teachers, I mistrust the schools, yet to say that they entirely trust their child's teacher or school, the case for which they have some evidence. And other people will claim to mistrust the police, but say that their local police officers, the cases for which they have some evidence, are trustworthy. Plenty of people, of course, claim to mistrust banks, but I do notice they have bank accounts to which they entrust their money. So there seems to be a discrepancy between the attitude and the practical side. Now, of course, when you push this, people say, well, where else can I keep it? And everywhere else is worse and things like that. But generic attitudes of mistrust persist, even when people judge that institutions and office holders are adequately trustworthy. Now, thinking about this across more recent years, I've asked myself, is polling evidence ever useful? What's it useful for? If they supposedly establish trust levels but don't actually provide robust evidence of trustworthiness, why are they useful? I think they're sometimes useful, but mainly not for showing who's trustworthy. I can think of two types of case where the questions asked by pollsters about trust offers quite useful evidence for specific but different purposes. For example, consumer reviews. You know, you're going to buy a new kettle or you're going to buy a new car, and you go online and you look at the consumer ratings. They rate the quality and the performance of the products and of the instructions for using them, and they're often extremely useful for other people who are considering buying the same products. But they're useful because they don't report generic attitudes. The consumer who does a review of whatever it may be, the kettle or the car, is actually experienced and is telling you what he or she found that car or kettle to be. So that seems to me a perfectly good use of polling evidence, with a practical point too. The other case I can think of is campaigning. So generic attitudes of trust and mistrust are very useful evidence if one's seeking to influence or manipulate those who hold the attitudes. For example, marketing departments use attitudinal evidence about what people trust to target potential customers and, of course, to avoid wasting money or time cultivating people whose attitudes aren't going to respond to their messages. Political parties and campaigning organizations also use evidence about generic attitudes of trust and mistrust, as well as about voting intentions, to identify which demographics they can usefully cultivate and where their effort would just be wasted. But polling evidence isn't generally useful for showing who's trustworthy. Polls are important, I suggest, in those parts of life where reputation is very influential or very significant, as in politics or marketing. Where reputational issues aren't so dominant and one actually cares about people getting things right, it doesn't seem to me likely that polls are as important. Where the rub is, as you will immediately have seen, is that some of us are in areas of life where both the reputational and the real matter. So what does one do when you've really got to secure accurate judgments of trustworthiness, but on the other hand, there's a temptation to look at the reputational issues? I think that puts one in a position, when one's thought about these things, to ask whether it's at all plausible that trust should be restored. It's a very standard response to the evidence we have of decline in trust, patchy, but some of it, in institutions and office holders, to say that, well, if it's low, if it's declined, what we need is to increase trust, to restore trust. And I think this type of response is pretty frequent in discussions of banking and more broadly of financial services, but far more widely of business, of the professions, where there's been a range of untrustworthy performance, and there has in many areas, by certain organisations and individuals, it's very tempting to say, oh, well, let's restore trust. But absolutely nothing would be gained by trying to raise levels of trust or restore supposed former levels of trust if institutions or office holders are not trustworthy. In fact, in that case, one's more likely to compound the damage by trying to restore trust in the untrustworthy. The well-named Mr. Madoff illustrated this point extremely well. As you all know, he ran off with a lot of other people's money using a successful Ponzi scheme and was unmasked. But it would not surely have been better if Madoff had been more trusted or trusted for longer, or people had made efforts to restore trust in Madoff. On the contrary, much better if he'd been trusted by fewer people for a shorter time and all the rest of it. So there's no general reason to seek to restore or increase trust. What matters, I suggest, is to align trust with trustworthiness and, by the same token, to align mistrust with untrustworthiness. And that, of course, needs evidence and good judgment, and that's much harder than parading one's generic attitude when the pollster rings to ask the question. Now, we're quite good, many of us, at aligning trust with trustworthiness in everyday life. because we don't need comprehensive or incontrovertible evidence or proof of others' trustworthiness or, alternatively, their lack of trustworthiness. Placing and refusing trust on the basis of incomplete evidence is often rational and, what's more, is generally unavoidable. A comparison with the task of forming reliable beliefs about other things is, I think, apt. Both in scientific inquiry and in daily life, we constantly have to reach beliefs on the basis of incomplete, not conclusive, evidence. And we do so by looking for relevant evidence for the specific claims and by subjecting our initial beliefs to further check and challenge to see whether they hold up. It's all utterly familiar. Both in institutional and in daily life, we constantly have to place or refuse trust on the basis of incomplete, not conclusive evidence of others' trustworthiness. Similarly, trust and mistrust can be placed intelligently if we can find relevant evidence about specific matters and allow that further evidence may demand reassessment. So the central practical question, to my way of thinking, is how to place trust intelligently despite the inevitable incompleteness of evidence that others' words are true of the world or that their acts will live up to their world, the two directions that trust faces. What I think we need in judging trustworthiness is generally specific and relevant evidence. Let me give you some everyday examples and then try to work into things that are more complex. If I want to work out whether a school can be trusted to teach maths well, whether a garage can be trusted to service my car, whether a colleague can be trusted to respect confidentiality, I need to judge their trustworthiness, the trustworthiness of that school, that garage, or that colleague in the relevant matter, not the generic attitudes that third parties hold about average or typical schools, garages, or colleagues. We're not lemmings, and we can base our judgments of trustworthiness on relevant evidence rather than on looking over our shoulders at other people's generic attitudes. But to judge whether others' claims or commitments are trustworthy, we typically do need evidence of certain specific sorts, particularly of the honesty, the competence, and the reliability that the person who, or institution that we're looking at is likely to bring to the task. Is A's claim about an accident that damaged his car honest? We know that, by the way, is an area of life in which there has been a lot of dishonesty. Is B's surgical competence adequate for her to undertake a complex procedure without supervision? Very important question. Or assuming that C is competent to walk home from school alone and that he honestly means to cross the road carefully, can we be sure that he'll reliably do so when walking with less diligent school friends? Is he impetuous or steady, forgetful or organised? Those are the everyday sorts of questions we ask. And in these everyday contexts, judging trustworthiness and lack of trustworthiness can be demanding, but it's often feasible, quick and intuitive, and the tasks are so familiar that it's easy to overlook how complex and subtle such judgments are. Placing and refusing trust in everyday matters often draws on complex, subtle, cultural and communicative capacities, such as abilities to note and respond to discrepancies in others' tone, in their words, and in their action. But these capacities, of course, are not infallible, but they're often sufficient for the purpose, and they can often be reinforced by additional and more intrusive checks or investigation, if warranted. But in institutional life, as you all know, this is much harder. Placing trust and mistrust well is harder, particularly in large and complex institutions, and these now dominate so much of life, and that's where we have to look. A lot of public, professional, and commercial life involves transactions that link many office holders, many parts of an institution, many institutions, often in many jurisdictions. No wonder it's difficult. This, I think, makes it very hard to judge trustworthiness, and two approaches have been used. The first, and it's utterly familiar to this audience, is to set enforceable requirements. These may be legal or regulatory. They may be backed by various forms of accountability. The second approach is more indirect, and seeks forms of transparency rather than imposing requirements. It is, of course, intended to create incentives for trustworthy action. Now, approaches that place requirements on institutions and office holders typically combine forward-looking and retrospective elements. Forward-looking requirements are instituted by enacting laws, by coordinating legislation in different jurisdictions, by supplementing primary legislation with regulation and guidance, and where relevant, by setting more precise technical standards. These are then developed and imposed by a process of institutional governance and administrative control. It's all very familiar and, of course, very complex. But in parallel with these forward-looking measures for improving trustworthiness, retrospective requirements are used to secure accountability by monitoring, checking, recording compliance with what has been required. Now, there's been a lot of criticism of approaches to accountability that are ineffective or disproportionate, and in particular of some that are said to be counterproductive because they undermine or damage the very performance for which office holders and institutions are being held to account. I once heard the negative effects of excessive demands for documented compliance very nicely illustrated by a midwife who told an inquiry looking into the safety of maternity care in England and Wales, by the way, quite good, but not as good as Scandinavia or the Netherlands. And she told the inquiry that it took longer to do the paperwork than to deliver the baby, which is an appalling state of affairs if true. Overcomplex ways of holding institutions and office holders to account are, of course, now widely derided. It's very unpopular. People hate it when it's applied to them. And it's true that they sometimes undermine rather than support capacities to carry the central tasks. At the limit, they can generate perverse incentives or incentives to game the system. And even when incentives are not actually perverse, they may offer limited or inadequate evidence for placing or refusing trust intelligently. And, of course, they are burdensome. That's what people dislike. The second, more indirect range of measures taken to improve trustworthiness focuses neither on placing requirements on institutions and their office holders, nor on holding them to account for compliance, but on making information about their action and their inaction and their shortcomings more transparent, thereby supposedly, as we all know, incentivizing better behavior, making it possible for others to judge their trustworthiness or untrustworthiness, and so on. Now, transparency is generally understood as a matter of placing the relevant information in the public domain. Untrustworthy performance may then be deterred, or may come to light, or may be penalized. But you notice it's may, not will. The approach is not new. Company accounts and auditors' reports have, after all, long been placed in the public domain, and we've used similar approaches in many other areas. However, I think transparency is not always helpful for those who need to place or refuse trust in specific institutions or office holders for specific actions or transactions or, of course, their omission. Material that's placed in the public domain may in practice be inaccessible to many for whom it might be useful, or it may be unintelligible to some of those who find it, or some of those who actually find it may find it intelligible but be unable to assess it. Transparency doesn't guarantee and often does not achieve communication, let alone dialogue with others. So, while placing information about performance in the public domain does provide additional incentives for better performance by institutions and office holders, its contribution to judging trustworthiness or restoring trust is, I think, more limited than people hoped. Many people have too little time, knowledge, and too many other commitments to find and use the information. So while additional law, additional regulation, more exacting accountability, and more transparency can all support more trustworthy performance, they're very often less effective than their advocates hope. Where too much is required, institutions and office holders may spend excessive time on compliance and, of course, on documenting compliance, sometimes to the detriment of the very matters for which they're being held to account. And in the worst cases, measures intended to improve accountability may themselves create perverse incentives and divert energies into producing an appearance of compliance, evidenced, of course, by high scores on dubious metrics, not to mention ticking all the right boxes, and so on. The idea that multiplying requirements and assembling and releasing ever more information about what's been done and achieved, the idea that that will always improve performance, is not borne out, and sometimes it's no more than fantasy, which is a pity in a way, but there it is. Now, given the difficulty of measuring, monitoring, and publicising, let alone communicating evidence of trustworthiness in institutional contexts, I think it's reasonable to ask what other ways there are to support good judgment of trustworthiness and untrustworthiness in those settings. In everyday life, I remind you, judging trustworthiness doesn't require comprehensive knowledge or judgments of others' honesty, competence, or reliability. And it draws extensively on cultural and communicative capacities by which we read situations and check and challenge others' judgments and our own. But in institutional life, there may be few analogues to the cultural and communicative capacities that support the intelligent placing and refusal of trust in everyday life. Difficulties, I think, mount in many institutional contexts because we may need to judge the trustworthiness of claims and commitments that are very complex or embody arcane expertise. And then that evidence may be communicated through multiple intermediaries, each of whom could, of course, fail in some way and whose trustworthiness is difficult to assess. Often it's hard for people to tell who originates or controls the claims that are made, whether claims and commitments are evidenced or invented, not to mention impossible, as well as disagree. And it's impossible, not to mention very disagreeable, to try reading the supposedly informative small print in the time available. I don't know whether any of you have cheered yourselves up by reading Michael Power's work. He's a professor of accountancy at the LSE, and in one publication, which I think is online, called The Risk Management of Nearly Everything, he pauses at a certain point to have a diatribe about small print. What is small print really for, he asks. Well, it does, on the whole, get things past the reader, because the reader is so put off by the smallness of the print and the rebarbative detail into which it goes. I don't know the answer to that, but I think it's a salutary warning. And we have so many intermediaries now. The situation, of course, has been made worse in the last year by widespread assertions that experts are not to be trusted. We now learn that Michael Gove meant to say economists, but he did say experts. And by the proliferation of fake news, the creation of echo chambers that proliferate claims regardless of their plausibility. Often the originators of claims and those who transmit them can remain anonymous. Often content is reformatted, reorganized, and distributed algorithmically rather than by others who are open to check or challenge. And so I think things have actually paradoxically got much harder. In a remarkably short time, we've moved from hoping that the new communication technologies would herald a brave new world of universal participation in discussion that would be helpful to trustworthy relations with others, even for democracy, to something entirely different. Rather than finding ourselves in a quasi-Habermasian world in which citizens can check and challenge one another's claims in an untrammeled discourse and reach reasonable views of their truth and their trustworthiness or otherwise, we find ourselves in a world where these very technologies not merely shape but often undermine or limit our abilities to assess the trustworthiness of the claims we encounter. Many of these problems arise not from the communications technologies themselves, but from the fact that they allow content to pass through numerous unidentified and often unknown intermediaries whose ability to modify content is also unknown and unascertainable by many, indeed most, audiences. So I suggest that judging trustworthiness has, in some contexts, become harder for most of us. And that is not because of the media we use, it's because of the extensive but typically large, invisible and unclear part played by intermediaries. So I'll say a little bit more about media and intermediaries, then I will stop. The new technologies of the last century, of course, support lots of media, but they also make it possible for communication to go through many intermediaries. Some of them are themselves institutions and office holders, but others are components or aspects of communication systems or determined by internal institutional processes. These intermediaries can shape, suppress, reshape what is communicated, often while remaining largely invisible, and without their contribution being known or understood by the ultimate recipients of the content that they either originate or modify. Now, is this proliferation of intermediaries rather than the specific features of communication media that I think mainly shapes and reshapes communicated content, and that can undermine processes for checking or challenging, corroborating or rejecting mediated claims and commitments, and limit capacities for judging trustworthiness and untrustworthiness. So in short, I think our situation's probably got a bit worse. Where intermediaries transmit communicated content, they may of course edit, alter, suppress, embellish, insert, omit, interpolate or distort the content. They may limit the intelligibility and the accessibility of claims and commitments in ways that overwhelm other people's capacities to judge trustworthiness and untrustworthiness, truth and falsity. I think that is, unfortunately, more or less the way things are. Both communicating and judging trustworthiness and lack of trustworthiness are helped when we have shared cultures that don't segregate people into silos or enclaves between which there's little communication. Communication and culture do more to support good judgment, in particular judgment of claims and commitments that travel through many intermediaries, when they travel through multiple pathways, because you get some purchase on what's going on by checking other things. Wittgenstein has a passage in which he remarks derisively how foolish to buy a second copy of the newspaper to check the first. Well, yes, if it's the same newspaper, but don't we all every day buy or look at other sources of information to cross-check? When messages travel by many paths, our abilities to note and respond to evidence of discrepancies in tone, words, action, and so to judge trustworthiness and untrustworthiness, can, I think, be supported by cultural as well as by formal, legal and institutional measures. Institutional cultures can, if they're of the right sort, supplement the more limited approach to judging trustworthiness that formal processes provide us. But, and here's the warning, as we all know, institutional cultures vary. Some are trustworthy, others are not. Some support and encourage ways of judging trustworthiness, others damage them. Cultures, like institutions and their office holders, may sometimes be corrupt or untrustworthy. And neither a corrupt culture nor a culture of mere compliance, merely law, regulation, accountability and transparency, is going to provide enough cultural support for judging or fostering trustworthiness. Institutional cultures that enable judgments of trustworthiness are likely to require engaged leadership, a degree of openness that permits and fosters communication and respect for evidence, and that permits and encourages habits of discussing, checking, and challenging others' claims. Effective cultures need not emerge spontaneously in large organizations and cannot be produced merely by tasking consultants with proposing a pretty set of values for the institution. So if we conclude that culturally mediated ways of judging trustworthiness are needed to augment those provided by institutional systems, I think it's worth working out what sorts of cultures might best be incorporated into institutional life. Rather than inflating and expanding formal system for securing compliance and accountability yet further, it may be that we would do better to foster cultures that support trustworthiness. It wouldn't be easy, but it would be a matter both of rejecting cultures in which fear, intimidation, corruption have a major part, as well as fragmented cultures that compartmentalize people in silos and enclaves, whether by imposing rigid hierarchies or by promoting libertarian forms of individualism, and by considering with care what cultures can contribute to improving and maintaining trustworthiness. So this, I think, is a task that we face, and I don't think it's impossible. We have to deal with the reality of communication flowing through multiple intermediaries. What we need are cultures that provide ways of checking and challenging at various points. Thank you very much.
Baroness O'Neill, thank you. So time, I reckon, 10, 15 minutes for some questions from the floor. Who wants to... while you're thinking about that, can I ask the first one? Which does take us to the question that you finished on, this proliferation of intermediaries. Very hard for us to turn back the tide on those. Mm-hmm. What is your sense? I mean, could we see some, over time, some Darwinian process whereby the truth eventually does reveal itself? Okay. Or is there a case, or do we need some intervention from someone somewhere to correct course on this? Is this a market process? Or is there a case for intervention to ensure this proliferation of intermediaries ultimately?
I think that this probably takes me to the edge of my technical understanding, because one of the problems of the proliferation of intermediaries is that we know that some of these intermediaries have algorithmically automated ways of proliferating. So that's what people mean by echo chambers. So that I doubt that we can do anything about that. However, I think I can't be the only person who has a beady eye on the internet service providers. I heard it being discussed on the radio only this morning, first time I've heard it on the radio, probably it's been there a lot. Do we think they should be accorded the status of platforms or publishers? And it's rather analogous to the court case against Uber. Were they just providing a platform, or were they employing the drivers? If you're a publisher, various bits of law apply. For example, the laws against defamation. If you're a platform and say, oh no, Joe Public or Jane Public put it there, nothing to do with me, Gov, then there's no redress there. And I think at present people have no redress. Those of you who have friends who have been pursued by completely false allegations that then proliferated out of hand will know exactly what I mean.
Let's take some questions, start there at the back.
In an effort to tackle the rise of this increasing amount of
vendors and fake news and the like, do you think trying to increase people's capacity for... Do you think it will lead to an increase in people's capacity for critical thinking, or do you think that should be encouraged in order to try and teach people how to spot and how to analyse information that they receive on a daily basis? Because trust is something you require when you don't have the understanding or the knowledge yourself. You have to make that belief or leap of faith to trust someone else. Whereas if you have that knowledge and that understanding yourself, it's no longer necessary. Do you think this will lead to an increase, or that should be encouraged?
I think that's a really fundamental question, and I don't know the answer to it. What we can do, as you know, there are all over the world, certainly all over this city, institutions that have dedicated themselves to improving the quality of evidence that is given to the public. They don't perhaps happen to control our media, but there is we're not as unfortunate as those in some jurisdictions. I don't know is the answer. How would one go about it? Well, step one, and everybody says step one is fine, education. But then you have to look at the recent work in psychology about the degree to which people gravitate towards reiterations of opinions very like their own. Mm-hmm. And I don't know whether you've picked up a recent book by Cass Sunstein, American political writer, called Hashtag Democracy, and then it goes you know, something like media and democracy. No, Hashtag Democracy. Was it Hashtag Republic? Hashtag Republic, I think. Now, Sunstein started out with the thought that some people were, as it were, feeding themselves a diet only of content that agreed with their previous opinions. And he dubbed it the Daily Me. Only when he got going did he discover that, in effect, the Daily Me already exists in multiple forms. So I think that the reason I kept using that slightly Popperian phrase, check and challenge, is I think that one of the great difficulties of these spiralling threads of messages is that you get the same message coming out again and again, and eventually you think, well, everybody thinks that. It's obvious.
Mark, do you want to...
Sorry, I just want to extend from your first answer and some of the other issues that I know you're thinking about, and use the example of the media companies and whether they're platforms or publishers, which is absolutely center stage. But then we can also think about other platforms in our economy. So an Uber, Deliveroo, that represent is they're effectively a labor, as you know, labor market platform. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they don't have a responsibility for, I'll call it workers' rights, just aggregate workers' rights responsibilities. And I'm going to make a statement which I'm not qualified to make and form it as a question, because is this an example of the difference between a justice and a duty? This is where I'm referring to some of the work I happen to know that you're thinking about, where the drift has been towards defining rights. But once those rights are there, then it's an almost libertarian approach to the duties that come with it. And so we have which is that potentially development through technology in our economy and our media, and our media as an economy as well, but also the economy, where we have the basic rights put in place, the right to work, the right to the information, but not the duty that comes with the norms that we historically had around a publisher or an employer in that case.
That's a deep question. I think that one of the things we can observe in the 20th century was that people stopped talking about freedom of speech and freedom of the press, and they started talking about freedom of expression. This was the phrase picked up in the human rights documents. It is, of course, now applied to expression means expression by any medium whatsoever. And the difference it makes is, I think, that when we were thinking of individuals, as John Stuart Mill did, he was thinking about rights of self-expression and the importance of not muzzling the individual if he or she said things that did not harm. He had, of course, quite different arguments in different chapters of On Liberty for freedom of the press. But we've got it all together now, and as you say, the libertarian tendency is to inflate the right to freedom of expression to all institutions, except insofar as their own codes or the law forbid it. So it's very extensive. And my guess is that it's reached a point where people have completely forgotten that there are any duties that go with speaking. And yet, if you think of some of the oldest ethical codes we have, I actually looked up the Ten Commandments the other day to check for myself. And you have, thou shalt not bear false witness, and thou shalt not blaspheme, what's given various translations, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Those are two speech duties. If you then rummage around, which I did for an hour or two, in some of the standard interpretations of these rites in the theological tradition, you find that a great number of speech duties are thought to fall under these two commandments. But, of course, commandments disappear because they're about duties, whereas we're thinking about rights. The oddity is nobody has any rights unless others have the counterpart duties to carry them. We don't call them duties now. We use the word responsibilities. It's a sort of downgrading, because a responsibility is something that you can, as it were, be assigned, or can somebody can take away from you. Whereas I think the duties that we see in the old religious texts and in the philosophical texts, Cicero would be a good example, are duties for everyone, and they aren't simply the corollaries of other people's rights.
Thank you. We'll go there. Thank you.
I was just wanted to follow up on the point where you talked about people only accessing things, points of view that agree with them. So the point you mentioned, that people only access views that they already believe in, is there not an even bigger problem nowadays, that even when you try to go and get some independent research, there are organisations out there that game the Google search engines to actually push the wrong views to the top?
Yeah, it is a problem. I mean, there is a serious problem with what is called research now. I've got a little agenda going. It's so simple that you will probably find it extremely odd that one needs to have an agenda on this, which is government-commissioned research, a lot of it about, funded by public money, your taxes and mine. However, what is it? What standards does it meet? Who has access to the information? There's no register of the publicly funded research commissioned by government. And smaller than the problem you mention of the search engines pushing things to the top. But I think we do have to take note of the discovery by a number of psychologists that we tend to hear what reinforces our existing views much more easily than we hear that which challenges our existing views. So, you know, I can think of worthy organisations here in London, Full Fact or Sense About Science, of which I used to be a trustee, and Evidence Matters and so on, working very hard to, as it were, get good evidence to the public, and so are the national academies. But is it going to work? I don't know.
I wanted to ask you two pieces of specific advice for the bank. The first one was about communicating when you're uncertain. And you often have a choice between... you have to make a judgment about how confidently you tell people you believe X is true, and also how openly you admit to not knowing the truth. So my question is, what's your advice about where to err on that spectrum? And the second question is, if you sense that trust is starting to dissipate, in general, do you think it's better to communicate more or less? And so how does the volume of how much you communicate affect trust?
Let me deal with trust, as it were, seriously, epistemically oriented trust, not with the stuff the opinion polls are talking about, which is attitudinal and revealing for some purposes, but I think not for trustworthiness. And what can we do about it? I think there's nothing that of a completely generic sort, but the way in which one can ensure that supposed evidence gets challenged is amenable to some institutional remedies, so that we have had historically all sorts of ways of doing cross-examination in a court, or the advocatus diaboli in the Catholic tradition, and so on. You can institutionalize checking and challenging. It's not perhaps something people like very much, because the familiar, what everybody thinks, is so popular. So I think you have to be quite a confident person to check and challenge. But, you know, I've sometimes wondered in reading the various literature around here, are we in an age where you have widespread scepticism? I'm not sure. Sometimes I think we might be in an age of great credulity.
I think this is a follow-up, actually, from the previous question. You mentioned various types of trust, and two, I think, are particularly important to financial institutions, including ourselves. One is that we do the right thing, and the other is that we do it competently.
Yeah.
And I think the two have become conflated in a lot of the commentary about what's happened over the past decade or so. Do you have any suggestions for how we as an institution, and more broadly the financial sector, can try to gain the confidence of our stakeholders on both, given their differences?
Competence is something that we probably all of us feel relatively familiar with, because it's something that we were taught to develop when we were young, and perhaps some of us would say, well, I might be competent for this, but not for that. You know, one person, oh, I would trust him to do the map reading, and I wouldn't trust this other person to do the map reading, and so on. So competence, I think, is something we can judge. I do think there's a bit of a gap between the ways in which we inculcate and certify competence with people who are learning stuff and the reality of it. And that, you know, sometimes it is people who can't perhaps articulate very clearly why, let's suppose it is a banking situation, why they're not going to make this loan. Maybe they're not very good at articulating it, but you might say, this is someone who usually gets it right. I listen very carefully to that one. So, you know, I think competence is the one that we can probably say some useful things about in context. Honesty is also something we can say something about, except for the very worrying thing that there are people who are, as it were, honest in one context of life and not in another. And there's certainly empirical evidence that honesty isn't, so to speak, like being 5'6", and you're 5'6" wherever you are. But there are people, for example, who are entirely honest in their professional lives but cheat in their marriage, or conversely. So I think we need to think less about traits than about the experience we have of people in specific activities. People have asked me why I introduced reliability as the third one there, and I suppose the answer is really extremely simple, that and I usually tell it with a small story. I have a friend who is as honest as the day, and I would trust him anything on to both be accurate and to qualify his views when he's not, and he's highly competent, but he is not very reliable. I wouldn't ask him to post a letter, you see what I mean. So I think that honesty and competence don't quite get it there, because it's got to be deployed in the right context on an everyday basis.
We're running out of time, so we'll take two last questions here.
Thanks. So I want to ask, is there a trade-off between getting your message across in the short term and focusing on building your own trustworthiness? As an example, I think climate science is like a very trustworthy institution, but they've been particularly bad at getting their message across because their opponents have managed to manipulate people's general attitudes toward trusts. So to what extent
it's a very striking example, isn't it? And I think climate scientists broadly, as far as I have read the literature, have been careful. The system, the climate system, is sufficiently complex that there are all sorts of things that they didn't predict or that where measurement has proved more difficult than they thought. So there's a degree of uncertainty. I have to say, one of the things one thinks about in this area is the question about who's an interested party. And I imagine there are whole websites devoted to revealing to us who is funding some of the climate skeptic blogs and so on. And it's an indirect way of judging the trustworthiness of a claim, but on the other hand, sometimes it's what we have. That wasn't a very complete answer. Sorry.
I wanted to is an observation, the difference between honesty and competence. I'm a competition economist, and we tend to describe competence as reputation and honesty as trust. And the two have different underpinnings. So, for example, competence as reputation, you can pinpoint that particular firm, for example, that doesn't have a good reputation for quality, it doesn't have a good reputation for competence, and therefore the blame for lacking reputation can be pinpointed to one individual firm. Whereas when we think about honesty and trust, there is what we call a negative externality, that if one firm betrays trust, there is a tendency to blame everyone. And the latest example, in my view, is Volkswagen, cheating on the diesel tests, and actually he hadn't had their sales weren't damaged too much, because I guess people tend to blame everyone, you know, they are likely to do the same. We have the same in banking and in energy, for example. There is all the discussion about restoring trust, but actually when there is general mistrust, the firms are benefiting from it, because mistrust inhibits competition, inhibits consumers voting with their feet. So collectively, they haven't got a very strong interest in restoring trust. Actually, they're better off with mistrust, meaning that consumers do not move and do not shop around.
Well, that is an interesting and a pretty pessimistic thought, that there's an advantage to be had from generalized mistrust. I think that people quite often think that in a situation in which there's a lot of untrustworthiness, mistrust is the safe policy. At least I won't get had, is the phrase, when if I mistrust everybody. But I have to say, that is not really a way in which one can live very much of life, because, among other things, if you think of it in a business or professional context, who will deal with somebody who is like that? And so I suspect that although it is a defensive position people adopt, it's not, it's A, not generalizable, and B, not as robust as it looks. The other one, you say some people are equating honesty with trust. I think that's quite a hard equation to push, because honesty is what we think a person or an institution is, and trust is our reaction to that honesty. So if I think that, for example, the doctor was honest when he told me that I had got this no more of this dire disease, then I will trust him, but it's my trust and the doctor's honesty.
On which note? I think we should draw things to a close. The timing of this seminar, as Mark mentioned at the very beginning, could not be better on the day that we launch the new version of our strategy. covering how we organise ourselves, how we build and develop our culture, and how we communicate both internally and externally. And Baroness O'Neill's lecture this afternoon has spoken very directly, I think, to both of those themes incredibly clearly, as Mark said, with huge wisdom, but also with a real practical relevance to what we do day by day. You drew the distinction in your talk between that which was reputational and that which was real. Actually, for us, it's both.
Well, that is why your task is difficult, and there are quite a lot of other people who have the combination in that they do need the reputation, but also they need to do the real thing as well. And I sometimes think that the people who push the polls are people in walks of life where reputation carries them much further than it would in yours.
I think that's all true. And the real hallmark of a good seminar is that when you go away and it forces you to think, and you give them a huge amount to take away and think about, certainly me a huge amount to take away and think about. But also you've challenged a number of the thoughts that I certainly had about these issues around trust and trustworthiness. Those self-reinforcing narratives you mentioned, it's challenges that we need. And that you've done today as well. I hope as many of you as possible can stick around for a quick drink just outside with Baroness O'Neill. But those who can't, and for all of us, please join me in thanking her in the usual way.